Anthony, who had spotted him floating on a raft in mid-ocean and effected his rescue. He said that his name was Sweeney Todd and that he had urgent business in London. From the moment he landed, his behavior was odd. He made his way to Fleet Street, where he paused outside the squalid little meat pie shop of a Mrs. Lovett, and as if on impulse, stepped inside. Mrs. Lovett was delighted to see a customer, but the strange visitor seemed more interested in the vacant rooms above her shop than her wares. 15 years ago, she told him, a young barber, Benjamin Barker by name, had lived there with his pretty wife and their baby daughter. The powerful Judge Turpin had lusted after the barber's wife and, with the aid of his bailiff, the Beadle, had convicted Barker on a trumped-up charge and had him transported to Australia for life. Once Barker's wife was completely at his mercy, the judge raped her, discarded her, and had taken her daughter, Johanna, into his house. As Mrs. Lovett tells this tale, it is revealed that the mysterious Sweeney Todd is in fact Benjamin Barker, who has escaped from the prison sentence and returned to avenge himself. His place as the master barber of London had been usurped by a man called Signor Pirelli, who also sold fake hair restorer through his servant Toby. Todd challenges him and in a unique manner displaces him. Sweeney Todd is the story of how vengeance was accomplished. The Holocaust that took place on Fleet Street is still remembered with a shiver to this day. It is a musical thriller in the 19th century Grand Guignol style of lots of blood and lots of suspense. Not unlike Tosca, really, but there's also quite a bit of humor in it, as you will hear, and of course this is being sung, acted for us in English. Once again, our cast, in order of appearance, tenor Cris Groenendaal in his Houston Grand Opera debut as Anthony Hope, a role he played in the original production after being a member of the ensemble. Baritone Timothy Nolen as Sweeney Todd, and of course we remember him vividly in the title role of Carlisle Floyd's Willie Stark, as well as the role of Junior in A Quiet Place. Soprano Adair Gockley as the beggar woman, mezzo Joyce Castle as Mrs. Lovett, bass Will Roy as Judge Turpin, Barry Busse as the Beadle, Lee Merrill as Johanna, and we will hear in the first act Stephen Jacob as Toby Ragg and Joseph Evans as Pirelli. On the podium, John Demain, and the lights have just gone down right here in Jones Hall, which indicates that John Demain will be coming out to begin this live performance of Stephen Sondheim's Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street. It's a very, very interesting, very striking set, which is rather difficult to describe. It seems to be a steel warehouse structure with catwalks and moving scaffolding. On the back wall will be projected a view of the London dockside of the 19th century. And set pieces, Mrs. Lovett's pie shop, Sweeney's barber shop, and places like that will be moved into place. They're much more stylistic than realistic. John Demain on the podium. And now, Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street, live from Jones Hall.
Sweeney Todd. His skin was pale and his eye was odd. He shaved the faces of gentlemen who never thereafter were heard of again. He trod a path that few have trod, did Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street.
He kept a shop in London town, of fancy clients and good renown. And what if none of their souls were saved? They went to their maker impeccably shaved. My Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street.
Sweeney,
lava boy the fancy chair. A bug and such of a leather straw, an apron, a towel, a pail, and a mug. Power of Thief Street.
Inconspicuous Sweeney was quick and quiet and clean. He was back of his smile under his word. Sweeney heard music and nobody heard.
Sweeney heard it, Sweeney heard like a crooked machine. He
Sweeney was smooth, Sweeney was subtle, Sweeney would blink and brass would scuttle. Inconspicuous Sweeney was quick and quiet and like a crooked machine. That's the play that he would want us to give it away. But Sweeney,
but Sweeney Todd, the demon brought the feast.
Has been kind to you. You will learn. It is here we go our several ways. Farewell, Antony. I'll not soon forget the good ship Bountiful or the young man who saved my life.
Oh, there's no cause to thank me for that, sir. It would have been a poor Christian indeed who'd have spotted you pitching and tossing on that raft and not given the alarm.
There's many a Christian would have done just that and not lost a wink's sleep for it either.
Arms, arms for a miserable woman on a miserable chilly morning. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
How would you like a little muff, dear? A little jig? A little bounce around the bush. Wouldn't you like to push me parsley? It looks to me, dear, like you've got plenty there to push.
Arms, arms for a pitiful woman. What's got wandering wits?
Hey, don't I know you, mister?
Must you glare at me, woman? Be off with you. Off, I say.
Then how would you like to slip me muff? So we'll go jig, jig a little.
Oh, my sake, to the devil with you!
For a pitiful woman.
Pardon me, sir, but there's no need to fear the likes of her. She was only a half-crazed beggar woman. London's full of them.
I beg your indulgence, boy. My mind is far from easy. For in these once familiar streets, I feel chill with ghostly shadows everywhere. Forgive me.
There's nothing to forgive.
Farewell, Antony.
Mr. Todd, before we part.
What is it?
I have honored my promise never to question you. Whatever brought you to that sorry shipwreck is your affair, and yet, during the many weeks of the voyage home, I've come to think of you as a friend and, well, trouble lies ahead for you in London. If you need help or money...
No!
There's a hole in the world like a great black pit, and the vermin of the world inhabit it, and its morals aren't worth what a pig could spit, and it goes by the name of London. At the top of the hole sit a privileged few, making mock of the vermin in the lower zoo, turning beauty into filth and greed. I too have sailed the world and seen its wonders, for the cruelty of man is as wondrous as Peru. But there's no place like London. There was a barber and his wife. She was beautiful. A foolish barber and his wife. She was his reason and his life, and she was beautiful, and she was virtuous, and he was naive. Another man who saw that she was beautiful, a pious vulture of the law, who with a gesture of his claw removed the barber from his plate. Then there was nothing but to wait, and she would fall, so soft, so young, so lost, and oh, so
did she succumb?
Oh, that was many years ago. I doubt if anyone would know. Now leave me, Anthony, I beg of you. There's something I must do, somewhere I must go, now and alone.
But surely we will meet again before I'm off to Plymouth.
If you want, you may well find me. Around Fleet Street, I wouldn't wonder.
Well then. So long then, Mr. Tom.
There's a hole in the world like a great black pit, and it's filled with people who are filled with shit, and the vermin of the world inhabit it!
You'll need
the street. Mrs. Mooney has a pie shop. Does her business, but I notice something weird. Likely all her neighbors' cats have disappeared. After and to her, what are calls? Enterprise, pumping Boosie's enterprise. Doing nice shop. Just the thought of it's enough to make you sick. And I'm telling you, them pussycats is quick. Now to know in times is hard, sir. Even harder than the worst boys in London. Only Lord and nothing more is that just revolting. Oh, greasy and gritty. It looks like it's molting and tastes like, well, pity.
Worse things than that down there.
Isn't that a room up there over the shop? If times are so hard, why don't you rent it out? That should bring in something.
Up there? Oh, no one will go near it. People think it's haunted. You see, years ago, something happened up there. Something not very nice. There was a barber and his wife, and he was beautiful, a proper artist with a knife, but they transported him for life, and he was beautiful. Barker, his name was Benjamin Barker.
Transported, you say? What was his crime?
Foolishness. He had this wife, you see. Pretty little thing, silly little nit, had her chance for the moon on a string. Poor thing. Poor thing. There were these two, you see, who wanted her like mad. One of them a judge, the other one his beadle. Every day they'd nudge and they'd wheedle. But she wouldn't budge from her needle. Too bad, pure thing. So they merely shipped the poor blighter off south, they did. Leaving her with nothing but grief and a year-old kid. Did she use her head even then? Oh no, God forbid. Poor fool. Oh, but there was worse yet to come. Poor thing. Johanna, that was the child's name. Pretty little Johanna.
Well, go on.
My. You do like a good story, don't you? Well, Beadle calls on her all polite. Poor thing, poor thing. The judge, he tells her, is all contrite. He blames himself for her dreadful plight. She must come straight to his house tonight. Poor thing, poor thing. Poor dear, poor thing, they're having this ball all in masks. There's no one she knows there, poor dear, poor thing. She wanders tormented and drinks, poor thing. The judge has repented, she thinks, poor thing. Oh, where is Judge Turpin, she asks. He was there all right, only not so contrite. Wasn't no match for such crap, you see. And everyone thought it so droll. They figured she had to be daft, you see. So all of them stood there and laughed, you see. Poor soul, poor thing.
It is. is you, Benjamin Barker.
Not Barker! Todd, no! Sweeney Todd. Where is she?
So changed. Good God, what did they do to you down there in bloody Australia or wherever?
Where's my wife? Where's Lucy?
Oh, poisoned herself. Arsenic from the apothecary on the corner.
I tried to stop her, I did, but she wouldn't listen to me.
And my daughter?
Johanna? He's got her.
He?
Judge Turpin?
Even he had a conscience tucked away, I suppose. Adopted her like his own. You could say it was good luck for her. Almost.
15 years sweating in a living hell on a trumped-up charge. 15 years dreaming that perhaps I might come home to a loving wife and child! Let them quake in their boots, Judge Turpin and the Beadle, for their hour has come.
You're going to get her. You, a bleeding little nobody of a runaway convict, don't make me laugh. You'll never get his eye and mightiness, nor the Beadle neither. Not in a million years. You got any money? Listen to me, you got any money?
No money!
Well, how are you going to live, even?
If I have to sweat in the sewers or in the plague hospital, I'll live and I'll have them!
Oh, you poor thing. You poor thing.
Quiet. See? They don't have to be the sewers of the plague hospital. When they come for the little girl, I hid them, I did. I thought, who knows, maybe the poor silly blight will be back again someday and need them. Cracked an head, wasn't I? Times as bad as they are, I could have got 5, maybe 10 quid for them any day. See? You can be a barber again. Ah, them handles is chased silver, ain't they?
Silver. Yes. These are my friends. See how they glisten. See this one shine. How he smiles in the light, my friend. My faithful friend, speak to me, friend.
Whisper, I'll listen.
I know, you've been locked out of sight all these years. Like me, my friend, well, I've come home to find you.
Mr. Todd,
you're warm in my hand, my friend, my clever friend.
Always had a fondness for you, I did.
Rest now, my friend.
Never you fear,
soon
Mr.
I'll
Todd.
Unfold you.
You can move in
soon
here,
you'll
Mr. Todd.
Splendors you never had dreamed on your day.
My
lucky friend,
in
all your
soft, his manner mild.
He seldom laughed, but he often smiled.
He'd seen how civilized men behave. He never forgot it, he never forgave.
Not Sweeney, not Sweeney Todd.
The demon barber of Fleet Street.
From the pearls of Spain to the rubies of Tibet, but not even in London have I seen such a wonder. Lady, look at me, miss, or look at me, please, or favor me with your glance. What do you see off there in those trees? Oh, won't you give me a chance? Who would sail to Spain for all its wonders, when in teary pain lies the greatest wonder yet? Oh, miss, look at you, pale and ivory-skinned. Oh, look at you, looking so sad, so queer. Promise not to retreat to the darkness back of your window. Not to you, look down here. Look at me. Look at me. Look at me.
Oops, for a miserable woman. I beg your pardon. It's you, sir. Thank you kindly.
Oh, one moment, Mother. Oh, perhaps you know whose house this is.
That's
the great Judge Turpin's house, that is.
And the young lady who resides there?
Ah, her. That's Johanna, his pretty little ward. But don't you go trespassing there, young man. Not if you value your hide. Turn there, and it's a good whipping for you, or any other youth with mischief on his mind.
Oh.
Hey, holy sailor boy, wanted it snugly harbored. Open the gate, but dock it straight. I see it list to starboard.
Here, take it me off. Me off with you now. Oh. Hey, which one sings the sweetest?
Oh, all the same, sir. Sixpence and cheap at the price.
Oh, he sings bravely. But why does he batter his wings so wildly against the bars?
Oh, we blinds them, sir. That's what we always done. We blinds them, and not knowing night from day, well, they sing and sing without stopping. A pleasure to bird, sir.
Dispose of him.
Dear, I knew it.
You heard his worship. Friend, I have no fight with you.
Get the gist of it, friend. Next time, it'll be your neck.
Your Honor, if I were to think you had encouraged that young rogue...
Oh, Barber, I forbade to be obedient to your commands.
Dear child, how sweet you look in that light muslin gown.
Oh. I'll steal. That walls can hide you. Even now I'm at your window. I am in the dark beside you. Buried sweetly in your yellow hair. I feel.
Butter. Majesty, the King of Naples.
Oh, Italian, all the rage is.
Not for long.
Oh, Mr. T, you really think you can do it?
By tomorrow they'll all be flocking after me like sheep to be shorn.
Oh, no, look, the Beadle Bamford.
All the better.
Oh, he recognizes me, and you...
I will do what I have set out to do, woman.
Oops, sorry, dear, I'm sure.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? Do you wake every morning in shame and despair from discovering your pillow is covered with hair? What a lovely bear. Well, ladies and gentlemen, from now on you can waken and eat. What takes who had a noggin so shiny and bare? The men friends all have heard of their right and their gentlemen, I was as bold as an egg when he named me Rose. But just look at me now. You can have my oats, tis unique. Rub a minute, stimulating in it. Soon you'll have to finish once a week. Penny buys a bottle guarantee.
Penny buys a bottle, might as well.
What you smell it?
Isn't it a crime then? Hurry, what the
heck? Gently dab it, gets to be a habit. Soon there'll be enough, sir. Somebody can grab it. See that chap with hair like Shelley's? You can tell he's yours, Pirelli's.
Let me have a bottle.
Make that two.
Pardon me, ma'am, what's that awful stench?
Oh, stand, I could get hope I can't. I don't know how to get my bag.
Pirelli's miracle elixir. Anything with slicks, soon sprouts curls. Try Pirelli's when they see how big, sir. You can have your picture of the girl.
What is this?
There's a buzz. The Pirelli soon will make a fixer. Like good elixir, always does. Trust Pirelli,
Sweeney Todd, and I have opened this bottle of Pirelli's elixir, and I say to you, it is nothing but an arrant fraud.
Ooh, he's right. Better to throw your money down the sewer.
Ladies and gentlemen, pay no attention to this madman.
And furthermore, senor, I have serviced no king, yet I wager I can shave a cheek and pull a tooth with 10 times more dexterity than any street mountebank. You see these razors?
The finest in England.
I lay them against 5 pounds. You are no match for me. You hear me, sir? Either accept my challenge or reveal yourself a sham.
Bravo! Bravo! Bravo.
These are indeed fine razors. Instruments like these, once seen, cannot be soon forgotten. You wager these against 5 pounds?
I do.
You hear this foolish man? Watch and see how he will regret his folly. £5 it is.
Friends, neighbors, who's for a free shave?
Me, Mr. Todd.
Me too, Mr. Todd, sir.
Over here, bring me a chair.
Boy, bring the basin, bring the towels. Quick!
Will Beadle Bamford be the judge?
As always, to oblige my friends and neighbors. Ready? Ready.
Ready.
The fastest, smoothest shave is the winner. Now, signorini, signori, we mix the lava, but first you gather around. Signorini, signori, you're looking a man who has had the glory to shave the poor Mr. Sweeney, whoever I beg your pardon, will probably say it was only a cardinal nook. It was a poop. But to shave the face, to pull the tooth, require the grace, and not the brute. For if you slip, you nick the skin, you clip the chin, you rip the lip a bit, and that's the truth. Or to shave the face, or even the part, without it a smart, require the heart, it take the heart. I show you a chart. I study a starting in my youth. To cut the hair, to trim the beard, to make the bristle ring like a whistle. This is from early infancy, the talents given to me by God. It takes the skill, it takes the brains, it takes the will. Or take the pines. It take the pace. It take the grace. The winner is Todd.
Smooth as a baby's arse.
Sir, I bow to a skill far defter than my own.
The £5.
Here, sir. And may the good Lord smile on you. Until we meet again. Come, boy. Signori, bellissime signorine. Buongiorno. Buongiorno a tutti. Ah!
You'd have thought it, dear. You pulled it off.
Mr. Todd, sir, do you have an establishment of your own?
He certainly does. Sweeney Todd's Tonsorial Parlor, above my meat pie shop on Fleet Street.
Mr. Todd, strange, sir, but it seems your face is known to me.
And? Now that's a lie. Him being my uncle's cousin, Walter Rye from Birmingham, only yesterday.
And yet, already I have heard Beadle Bamford spoken of with great respect.
Well, sir, I do my best for my neighbors. Fleet Street. Over your pie shop, ma'am.
That's it, sir.
Then, Mr. Todd, you will surely see me there before the week is out.
You will be welcome, Beadle Bamford, and I guarantee to give you, without a penny's charge, the closest shave you will ever know.
Sweeney pondered and Sweeney planned like a perfect machine. He planned.
Bobbing the hook, making a trap,
setting it out for the beetle to snap. Slyly courted him, Sweeney did. Sad the son of a sin, he did. Playing the trail, showing the traces, letting it lead to higher places.
Playing the trail, showing the traces, letting it lead to higher places. Lying is better than showing the traces.
Stomach cramps to happen.
neighborhood. Come on, dear. Have a heart, dear.
Off with you. Ain't got a kick on the rough that'll make your teeth chatter.
Stuck up thing. You and your fancy airs.
Why doesn't Beadle Bamford come? Before the week is out, that's what he said.
And who says the week's out? It's only Friday. Easy now. Hush, love, huff. Don't distress yourself. What's your rush? Keep your thoughts nice and lush. Why? Hush, love, huff. Think it through. What's involved then? What's to do? Watch it close. Let it grow.
I've been thinking flowers, maybe daisies, to brighten up the room.
The judge! When will I get to him?
Can't you think of nothing else? Always brooding on the wrongs that have happened heaven knows how many years ago.
Slow, love, slow. Time so fast. Now goes quickly. See, now it's past. Soon will come. Soon will last. Wait. Don't you know? Silly.
But now the sign. In business already. Well, I congratulate you. Oh, and I...
Mrs. Lovett, sir.
Oh, it's a pleasure, ma'am. Oh, Mr. Todd, I have so much to tell you. I have found the fairest and most loving maid that any man could dream of. And yet there are problems. For she has a guardian so tyrannical she is kept shut up from human eye. But now, this morning, this key fell from her shuttered window. The surest sign that Johanna loves me.
Johanna?
Oh, that's her name, ma'am. And, Turpin, that of the abominable parent. A judge, it seems, the monstrous tyrant. Mr. Todd, once the judge has gone to court, I'll slip into the house and plead with her to fly with me tonight. Yet when I have her, where can I bring her till I have hired a coach to speed us home to Plymouth?
Bring her here, dear.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Oh, I have your consent, Mr. Todd.
The girl may come.
Oh, I shall be grateful for this to the grave. But I must hurry now, for surely the judge is off to the Old Bailey. Oh, my thanks. A thousand blessings on you both.
Johanna, who the boarded? It's like fight, isn't it? You'll have your daughter back before the day is out.
For a few hours, before he carries her off to the other end of England.
Who? That sailor boy? Let him bring her here. And then since you're so hot for a little... Shh. That's
the throat to slit, dear.
Oh, Mr. T, we'll make a lovely home for her, you and me. The poor thing. All those years, not a scrap of motherly affection. Well, I'll soon change that, I will. For if ever there was a maternal heart, it's mine.
Good morning, Mr. Todd, and the ubellissima signorina.
Well, how do you do, signor, I'm sure.
A little business with Mr. Todd, signor. Perhaps if you will give the permission.
Oh, yes, of course. I'll just pop down to me pies. Oh, Lord, look at it now. Don't look like it's had a kind word since half past never. Who would you say, son, to a nice, juicy meat pie?
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Well, then come with me, lad. Your teeth is strong, I hope.
Mr. Todd!
Signor Pirelli.
Call me Danny. Daniel O'Higgins the name, when it's not professional. Not much, but I imagine you'll pretty it up a bit. I'd like me 5 quid back if you don't mind.
Why?
That's my boy, tuck in.
It'll hold me over till your customers start coming. Dan, it's half your profit you'll hand over to me every week on a Friday. Share and share alike, all right? Mr. Benjamin Barker.
Why do you call me that?
At least you got a nice, healthy Adair on you.
Oh, well, Mom, to tell the truth, Mom, gets awful hot.
You don't remember me. Why should you? I was just a down and out Irish lad you hired for a couple of weeks, sweeping up hair and such like. But I remember these. And you. Benjamin Barker, later transported to Botany Bay. For life. So, Mr. Todd, is it a deal? Or do I run down your street for me pile of Beadle Bamford? You tinker, you smart! You foolish boy! Tomorrow you start in my employ! You understand? You like my plan!
Oh, God! He's got an appointment with his tailor! If he's late and it's my fault, you don't know him!
I wouldn't want to, I'm sure, dear.
Signora! It's late! The tailor's hot!
Oh, hold me, please!
Signora! I give back his man! I remind you, Jim! The tailor's hot!
Oh, he ain't here.
Signor Pirelli's been called away. You'd better run after him.
Where did he go?
He didn't say.
Oh, no, sir. No answer, but I'm always to the contrary. I best wait for him here.
So, Mrs. Lovett gave you a meat pie, did she, my lad?
Yes, sir. She's a real kind lady. One whole pie.
Whole pie, eh? Well, that's a treat. Yet, if I know a growing boy, there's always room for more, eh?
I'd say, sir, an aching boy.
Then why don't you run downstairs and wait for your master there? There'll be another pie in it for you, I'm sure. And tell Mrs. Lovett to give you a nice big tot of gin.
Ooh, gin, sir! Boy, you're a Christian indeed, sir! Thank you, kindly! Gin!
Oh, ma'am! The gentleman says to give me a nice tot of gin, ma'am.
Gin, dear?
His hands were quick, his fingers strong. It stung a little, but not for long. And those blood in the sinful blood, who greet him sinnery under the sod, consigned her with a friendly prod from Sweeney Todd. The demon barber of Fleet Street.
See your razor gleam, Sweeney. Feel how well it fits.
How well it fits.
As it floats across the throat of hypocrite.
This is the court time. sir, you have been brought before this bench. Though it is my earnest wish ever to temper justice with mercy, your persistent dedication to a life of crime is such an abomination before God and man that I have no alternative but... Court adjourned. It is perhaps remiss of me to close the court so early. The stench of those miserable wretches at the bar was so offensive to my nostrils, I feared my eagerness for fresher air might well impair the soundness of my judgment. Come, walk home with me, for I have news for you. In order to shield her from the evils of this world, I have decided to marry Johanna next Monday.
Ah, so, happy news indeed.
Strange. When I offered myself to her, she showed a certain reluctance. There, that's natural enough in a young girl. Now that she has had time for reflection, I'm sure she will receive my proposal with a more sensible frame of mind. Come, let us discuss.
I have a plan.
Must swallow poison on Sunday. If that's what I'll do, I'll get some.
I have a plan.
Oh,
a plan. A plan.
He is in court. He's in court today. Still, there was a noise. What's a bad noise? You must have heard the...
Kiss me.
Oh, sir.
Oh, miss.
Oh, sir. If he should marry me Monday, what shall I do? I'll lie.
We fly tonight.
Tis Friday. First day Sunday. What can we do with time?
We fly tonight. Tonight, it's not a gate, there's no gate. We don't have a gate. If you don't need, listen. Kiss me.
Tonight.
Kiss me.
Tonight.
The plan is made, so kiss me.
I fear
the plan. Be not afraid tonight, I steal. Of course, you're sure I shall.
Yes, yes, but the gratitude she owes me as her guardian should be sufficient to kindle a more tender emotion.
Excuse me, my lord. May I request my lord permission, my lord, to speak? Forgive me if I suggest, my lord, you're looking less than your best, my lord. There's powder upon your vest, my lord, and stubble upon your cheek. And ladies, my lord, are weak.
Less than my best, you say?
And ladies in their sensitivity, my lord, have a fragile sensibility. When a girl's emergent, probably it's urgent, you defer to her gentility. My lord, personal disorder cannot be ignored, given their genteel proclivity.
You say? Well, perhaps at times I am a bit over hasty with my morning ablutions.
Fret not, though, my lord. I know a place, my lord, a barber, my lord, of skill. Thus armed with a shield and face, my lord, some eau cologne to grace, my lord, and musk to enhance the chase, my lord, to dazzle the girl until she bows to your every will.
That may well be so.
Well, here we are, sir. I bid you good day.
Good day, Beadle. Beadle! Perhaps you are right. Where is this miraculous barber?
Nearby, in Fleet Street, sir.
Take me to him.
The name is Todd.
Best to acquaint him with.
Can I concur?
It's right, we'd best be married on Sunday.
Saturday, sir, with all sir.
Or else tonight.
Another noise.
Like what?
Never mind, just a noise.
He mustn't mind, it's a noise. Just another noise. Something in the street, just a kiss.
We'll go to Paris on Monday.
What shall I wear? I dare not ask.
Take the train.
With you beside me on Sunday. What will I care what things I lack?
To Spain.
What
shall
your reticule?
Go buy a reticule.
I'm your thing.
You're a fool. What a reticule.
Be
on the side and begin again and kiss
me.
I know a place where we can go tonight.
Kiss me.
My love, darling, and as I saw you, and as it did not matter that I did not say.
Blackmail me, half my earnings forever.
Oh, well, that's a different matter. What a relief to you. For a moment there, I thought you'd lost your marbles. All that blood. It's not to make you come all over goose flesh, ain't it? Poor bugger. Oh, well. £3. Well, waste not, want not. Now, dear, we've got to use the old noggin.
There you are, sir. Above the pie shop, sir.
Oh, I see. You may leave me now, Beadle.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Well, first there's the lad downstairs.
Send him up here.
Him too? Now, surely one's enough for today, dear. Shouldn't indulge yourself, you know. Now, let me see. He's half-seas over already with the gin.
Providence is kind.
Who is he?
Judge Turpin.
He, the judge, he can't be.
Leave me quick.
But wait, what did you
do? Leave me, I said.
Don't worry, dear, I'm out. Excuse me, your lordship.
Mr. Todd.
At your service, sir. An honor to receive your patronage, sir.
Now, dear, it seems like your governor's gone left you high and dry. But don't worry, your Aunt Nellie'll think of what to do with you. Come on into my lovely back parlor.
These premises are hardly prepossessing, and yet the Beadle tells me you are the most accomplished of all the barbers in the city.
'Tis gracious of him, sir. And as for my premises, you must please forgive their modesty. It's only a few days ago that I moved in, and some necessaries are yet to come. Sit, sir, if you please, sir. Sit.
See how nice and cozy it is. Sit, dear, sit. Oh, it's empty. Now, you just sit there, not like a nice good boy, while I get a new bottle from the larder.
And what may I do for you, sir? A stylish trimming of the hair? A soothing skin massage?
You see, sir, the man infatuate with love, her ardent and eager slave. So fetch the pomade and palmerstone, and lend me a more seductive tone, a sprinkling, perhaps, of French cologne. But first, sir, I think, a shave.
The closest I ever gave.
If you're in a merry mood today, Mr. Todd,
'tis your delight, sir, catching fire from one man to the next.
'Tis true, sir, love can still inspire the blood to pound the heart desire. What more
what
can
man
require than love, sir?
More than love, sir.
What, sir?
Winning.
It's women.
Pretty women.
Lady,
Sunday. Everything set.
You! What's happened?
There is indeed a higher power to warn me thus in time. Johanna elope with you? Deceiving slut! I'll lock her away in some obscure retreat where neither you nor any other vile corrupting youth will ever lay eyes on her again!
Absurd, Beggar!
And as for you, Barber, it's all too clear what company you keep. Service them well and hold their custom, for you shall have none of mine out of my way!
Mr. Todd!
You never see the light of day again. Oh, little witch deceived me like this.
Out, I say! Out!
All this running and shouting, what is it now, dear?
I had him, and then...
the sailor busted him. I saw them both running down the street, and I said to myself, the
his foot was there, and you'll never come again.
Hush, love, hush, I keep telling you. When?
Why did I wait? You told me to wait. You'll never come again. There's a hole in the world like a great black pit, and it's filled with people who are filled with shit, and the remnant of the world inhabited. But not and the one with his foot in the other one's face. Look at him, Mrs. Lovett, look at you. So we all deserve to die. Even you, Mrs. Lovett, even I. Because the lives of the wicked should be made brief, for the rest of us death will be a relief. We all deserve to die. Come and visit your good friend. You, sir, too, sir, welcome to the grave. I will have vengeance. I will have salvation. All right, you, sir, no one's in the chair. Come on, come on! Sweeney, waiting! I want you, leaders. Anybody? Gentlemen, now don't be shy. Not one man, no, nor 10 men, nor 100 can assuage me. I will have you. I will get him back, even as he gloats. In the meantime, I'll practice on this honorable throat.
Baby lamb. Later I can fob him up with some story easy. But him, what are we going to do about him?
Later on, when it's dark,
We'll take him to some secret place and bury him.
Well, of course, we could do that. I don't suppose he's got any relatives going to come poking around looking for him. Well, you know me. Bright ideas just pop into my head. And I was thinking, seems a downright shame.
Shame?
Seems an awful waste. Such a nice plump frame. What's his name has had. Debts to be erased. Think of it as thrift, as a gift, if you get my drift. No, seems an awful waste. I mean, with the price of meat, what it is, when you get it, if you get it. Good, you got it. Take your instance, Mr. Green, at the pie shop. Business never better, using only pussycats and toast. Now a pussy's good for maybe six or seven at the most. And it surely can't compare as far as taste.
Mrs. Lovett, what a charming notion. Well, eminently practical and yet appropriate waste. As always. Mrs. Lovett, how it's I did without you all these years, I'll never know. How delectable.
But
so undetectable. Our choice, how rare. These are desperate times, and desperate measures are called for.
Here we are, hot from the oven.
What is that?
It's priest. Have a little priest.
Is it really good?
Sir, it's too good, at least. Then again, they don't come, it's sins of the flesh. So it's pretty fresh.
Awful lot of fat.
Only where it sat.
Haven't you got poet or something like that?
Now you see, the trouble with poet is how do you know it's deceased? Try the priest.
Heavenly. Not as hearty as bishop, perhaps, but not as bland as curate, either.
And good for business, too. It always leaves you wanting more. Trouble is, we only get it in Sundays. Lawyer's rather nice.
If it's for a price.
Order something else, though, to follow, since no one should swallow it twice.
Anything that's lean.
Well, then, if you're British and loyal, you might enjoy Royal Marine. Anyway, it's clean. Though, of course, it tastes of wherever it's been.
Is that squire on the fire?
Mercy no, sir. Look closer. You'll notice it's grosser.
It's thicker. More like thicker.
No, it has to be grosser. It's green.
The history of the world, my love.
Save a lot of graves to a lot of relatives' favors.
Is those below serving those up above?
Everybody shaves so there should be plenty of flavors.
How gratifying for once to know that those above will serve those down below.
Tinker?
No, something pinker.
Tyler?
No, something paler.
Potter?
No, something hotter.
Butler?
No, something subtler.
Locksmith?
No, something...
A lovely bit of Clark.
Maybe for a lark.
Then again this week, if you want it cheap and you're like a dog, try the financier, peak of his career.
That looks pretty rank.
Well, he drank, it's a bang, cashier. Never really sold, maybe it was old.
Have you any Beadle?
Next week, so I'm told. Beadle isn't bad till you smell it and notice how well it's been greased. Stick to priest. Now, this might be a bit stringy, but then, of course, it's fiddle player.
Ah, no, no, that's not fiddle player. That's piccolo player.
How can you tell?
It's piping hot.
Then blow on it first.
The history of the world, my sweet.
Oh, Mr. Todd, oh, Mr. Todd, what does it tell?
Is who gets eaten and who gets to eat.
And Mr. Todd, too, Mr. Todd, who gets to sell.
But fortunately, it's all so clear that everybody goes down well with me. No, no. Too salty. I prefer general.
With or without his private?
What is that?
It's fop. Finest in the shop. Then we have some shepherd's pot peppered with actual shepherd on top. And I've just begun. Here's the politician, so oily. It's served with a doily. Have one.
Put it on a bun. Well, you never know if it's going to run.
Try the fryer, try it's drier.
No, the clergy is really too coarse and too mealy.
Then after, that's compactor.
Yes, and always arrives overdone. I'll come again when you have judge on the menu.
Right. True. We don't have judge yet. But would you settle for the next best thing?
What's that?
Executioner. Yes, yes, I know, my love.
We'll take the customers that we can get.
High, born, and low, my love.
We'll not discriminate great from small. Nor we'll serve anyone, meaning anyone, and to anyone at all.
And with that grisly bit of comedy, we come to the end of Act One of Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street, a musical thriller by Stephen Sondheim, with book by Hugh Wheeler after Christopher Bond's play. Houston Grand Opera live from Jones Hall this evening.
Sweeney Todd, what was it that made you want to come up with this thing we have on our stage tonight?
Well, I saw Christopher Bond's play because I've always been interested in Grand Guignol and horror movies, and I've always wanted to do a musical that scared people. And that's the idea of this musical. I wasn't looking for anything. I just happened to be in London when Bond's play was on, and I went to see it because I was curious. I'd heard about Sweeney Todd, which has been in existence for 140 years. Little did I know that I was going to see a new version, which is so much better than all the old versions. The old versions are kind of silly. Bond is the first one to take the legend seriously. In England, the legend of Sweeney Todd is like the legend of the boogeyman. Here, it's something you scare children with to make them go to bed or to eat their cereal. Nobody takes it seriously until Christopher Bond came along, because it just used to be a story about a villain, type villain, and Bond humanized him and made this story a revenge. And I found it both charming and scary. And on the way home, I suddenly thought, gee, it would sing very well. And it kind of lays out like a musical. So I got what I thought was the same play, except I got it out of the British Museum and found out, of course, that was the 1836 version. And then I read the six other published versions, because it's been done in so many versions over a period of 150 years. And then finally got the Bond version, and it was as different as night from day, and then proceeded to try to get the rights to it. And there were a pair of producers in New York who'd also been negotiating for the rights, so we got together, and their names were Barr and Woodward, and I said I'd like to do it as a musical. They were going to do it as a straight play. And they said yes, so I proceeded to write it. But the idea of the show was merely I wanted to scare people, and I realized that the problem with scaring people in a musical is that the minute people start singing songs, the reality drops. Or, if they're singing, then the minute they start speaking, the reality drops. And the whole point of a horror movie, and what scares you essentially, is the music. I mean, if you look at Jaws, it's not the underwater shots that scare you, it's the music that John Williams wrote that goes along with the underwater shots. And I realized the way you could scare an audience was to keep music constant throughout the show. Because I wanted to scare them on their own terms. It's very hard to scare an audience in the theater in our day and age. It's so much scarier out on the street than it is in the theater. And also, we're so used to movies with lots of gore and that sort of thing. You know, 100 years ago, the theater was the only form of this kind of entertainment, or perhaps opera. And so they had what they call blood and thunder theater, with people, you know, slitting each other's throats and lots of stage blood. Today, it's very hard to scare an audience in the theater, and it happens very rarely. I can't even remember the last time there was a genuinely scary play done on Broadway. Death Trap was the last hit, but that was essentially a comedy. But with music, if you keep the music going throughout, you can mesmerize an audience and make them take it on its own terms. So instead of laughing at the stage blood, they will go with it. They will fall into the fantasy and have a good time as you have at a horror movie. And that's all this piece is supposed to be, is a horror movie. It's got a terrific story, and it should scare you and surprise you, and has a lot of plot twists. And that's what it's about. You know, it's nice of you to say it's important, but that's not the intention. The intention is to do a scary musical.
Well, I guess the truly important works never started out as being important, but Shakespeare started out by doing Macbeth, and I think...
He was a hired playwright. He had to write plays to earn a living. Bach wrote a cantata every Sunday. Again, that was the way he earned a living.
And it just turned out that way. Yeah, it's interesting making comparisons or connections. I think comparisons is a bad word, but connections. Well, with Shakespeare and Macbeth, you have two very, very unlikable people that the audience is going to feel something for, the way Shakespeare created Mr. and Mrs. Macbeth.
Well, it's not quite the same thing, because Macbeth and his wife are ambitious. Todd is somebody who's been wronged. You see, I don't think he's unsympathetic at all. A man to whom that kind of injustice has been done is a sympathetic person. Mrs. Lovett is not so sympathetic, because she's venal. But Todd is somebody who has been deeply wronged, and he's out for revenge, and he becomes a monster, but the motivation is not the kind of selfishness that Macbeth and his wife represent, even though, you know, they are grandiloquent villains. Nevertheless, it comes from a sense of selfishness.
Yeah. You know, you mentioned music, and that music can be scary, and also the genre can work against it. I think of an operatic connection, which we've had here this season, is, of course, the great Grand Guignol opera, Tosca, which I can't imagine scaring anybody anymore.
Also, I don't
the way it did originally.
I wouldn't call that Grand Guignol. See, my understanding of Grand Guignol is lots and lots of, as I say, stage blood and screams and people popping out of dark doorways. Tosca's a melodrama. I mean, so is Sweeney Todd, but, you know, Tosca really is a kind of Betty Davis movie. It's about confrontation and thwarted love and thwarted ambition and that sort of thing. I don't think of it as Grand Guignol. Grand Guignol to me is lots of dead bodies. And I may have the wrong definition, but that's what it means to me.
Well, there are three in Tosca.
Yeah, well, that's not a lot. That's not a lot as far as I'm concerned. And I never think of three, really. I suppose you're right. Except that, you know, in most operas, most grand operas, there are a number of dead bodies. It's the tone, I think. Grand Guignol is like very exaggerated melodrama. In our case, it is literally, it was, as I said earlier, I think, in the 19th century in London, this play was done at something called the Britannia, which was called a blood and thunder theater. And that's literally what it is, blood and thunder. Thunderstorms, meaning lightning flashes, thunder sheets off stage, and stage blood. And it never pretended to be anything but that. Whereas Tosca is a drama. It's a melodrama, but it's, you know, it's a drama. Anyway, it's a matter of terms, I suppose.
Yeah. I think it's also the audience looking at it, or when the audience looks at it, maybe 100 years from now, people will see Sweeney Todd different from the way, not so much the way you see it, but the way we see it, the way Puccini's audience saw it at that time, too. And I'm wondering if the show he wrote for his audience is not that much different from the show you've written for your audience. We have a way of venerating what he did because of the vantage of time, but I wonder if you're not working in cousin genres.
Oh, I think so, but I think that has very much to do with libretto. Puccini was real smart in that he always took plays that were very melodramatic. He took Belasco plays, and he took Sardou plays. He did not take Chekhov, and he did, you know, he took great, big, robust melodramas in which people are constantly at the top of their emotions, chewing the scenery, hiding, killing, etc., etc., and it made for heavy, high drama, which allowed the music to blow the people up, so they never got too big because they were larger than life to begin with. And again, the sense of drama is maintained by the constant use of music. The reason there's so much singing in Sweeney Todd is not that I was trying to write an opera, far from it. I just wanted to keep music going all the time so the audience would never have a chance to catch their breath. So that when there are silences in Sweeney Todd, it's for a purpose. But the idea is, if the music is continuous, whether it's sung or underscored, the audience will keep in the mood and they will forget they're in the middle of the 20th century or the end of the 20th century and in a large theater watching a lot of people with stage makeup and stage blood. And Puccini had that sense, too, that melodrama will hold. Belasco started talking about it, wondering who the people were and what their relationships with each other might be, etc., etc. And from that, and we added the one other character, which is the painter, who's the only one who's not in the picture. And from that, we started to develop a piece that is essentially about what an artist is about and what art is about and what strolling is about and what Sundays are about and what certain kind of class structure is about and what farce is about. And it just sort of went off in all directions. But primarily, it's a celebration of the painting. We just wanted to celebrate the painting, that's all.
And turning a painting into music.
Yep, exactly. And of course, Seurat, you know, developed a technique called divisionism or pointillism, which is the use of absolutely pure color, not mixing colors, but making many, many, many thousands of dots of color, some so that by contrast next to each other and by complementing each other, the eye, when you stand far enough away from the picture, mixes the colors, and you lose any of the light value that you would lose if you put one color on top of another or mixed it with another. You would lose a certain amount of light value because they would cancel each other out to a certain extent. But the eye, mixing pure colors, his theory was, imparts a shimmer to the painting just because it's pure color. And there are only 11 colors in the picture, which is quite remarkable. It's 10 by 7 feet, and it's got every color in the universe virtually. But it uses no blacks and no earth tones. It's all just red and blue and yellow and green and violet and the variations of those, and white, and the variations of those. And from that, he's able to create an illusion, so to speak. And the picture is quite remarkable. You can stand in front of it for many hours and never get tired of it. And you start to trance out when you watch it, as a matter of fact. You start to enter the world. Because it's also a very strange, dreamlike painting. And so I thought that would be fun to kind of mirror musically. And I try to give the music the kind of shimmer that the painting has.
Yeah. Well, speaking of colors, earth tones and dark colors, we have the second act of Sweeney Todd coming up just a moment. Stephen Sondheim, thanks for joining us, and thanks for giving us Sweeney Todd.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Some of the best things in life are free, like the sight of my neighbor's boy riding a bicycle for the first time. Although he was wobbling all over the place, he was keeping his balance real well, and my neighbor was proud. But he says, you know, everything has its price. Jimmy's getting to be a big boy now, and I'd like to add on to the house so he could have a room of his own, but, well, that's going to take money. So I said, well, you should come by First City and talk with our people about a home improvement loan, or any kind of loan for that matter, because at First City, we know that a growing family like yours has growing needs. And that usually translates out to more money now. Well, about then, Jimmy rode by with a big grin on his face, and I said to my neighbor, boy, there's some things in life that money can't buy. But a First City loan can help you enjoy the things that it can. We're First City, reaching further, doing more. Members FDIC.
here we are back in Jones Hall. The audience has returned to its seats. We're waiting now for the lights to go down and John Domingue to come to the podium for the second act of the musical thriller Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street. What happens in the second act? Well, the plot is now wound up, as we have heard. And we discover with the very beginning of the second act that Mrs. Lovett's plan has been doubly successful. Sweeney is getting a lot of practice with his razor, and Mrs. Lovett is turning people away from her now very successful pie shop. And we'll hear the chorus drinking and eating in the very, very first scene. But still, the beadle and the judge have not returned to Sweeney's barber shop, and that, of course, sticks in his craw. We also discover that Johanna has been immured in Fogg's asylum. It's quite popular, if that's the word for it, in the Victorian period, to lock up people in bedlam, not because they were mad, but just to get them under safe keeping. And so Anthony tries to save her. He comes to Sweeney, and Sweeney offers him a solution, as you'll hear. We talked during the interview about the connection, some connections between Sweeney Todd and Tosca. You'll discover there are similarities in a rather bizarre way with the Barber of Seville, but I won't spoil the fun of that. Also, in the finale of Sweeney Todd, which takes up just about the second half of the second act, we discover that things do not turn out quite the way Sweeney planned. We will discover who the beggar woman is, for instance, and we will actually be in the bakehouse where the pies are baked. There have been complaints from some of the people of the town because of the stench coming from the chimney, and poor Toby will quite accidentally be the engine of all the turns that the end of Sweeney Todd takes. Music and lyrics by Stephen Sondheim, the book by Hugh Wheeler, from an adaptation, again, of Christopher Bond's play, of a legend that in several different guises and several different names go back actually several centuries in English urban folklore. Our cast, Timothy Nolen, is Sweeney Todd. Joyce Castle is Mrs. Lovett. I should tell you that she is a good-looking redhead made to look rather ratty in this particular production. Her hair done up in two French twists on either side of her cranium in a rather nondescript outfit. Nondescript, when it would be hard to figure out exactly what the shape is. Cris Groenendaal, tall and blonde as Anthony Hope. Lee Merrill, short and blonde, is Johanna. Barry Busse is the Beadle. Will Roy is Judge Turpin. Adair Gockley is the beggar woman. We will hear as Johanna Lee Merrill. Stephen Jacob is Toby. And as Jonas Fogg, the man who runs the asylum, Rodney Stenborg. I might mention the name Turpin, as in Judge Turpin. Dick Turpin was an infamous highwayman in English folklore. Applause for John Domingue, who's asking the orchestra to stand. And now we will hear Act Two of Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street, live from Jones Hall.
Gourmets among you will tell you, of course. Ladies and gentlemen, you can't imagine the rapture in store just inside of this door. Mrs. Lovett's meat pies conjure up the treat pies used to be.
Over here, boy, how about some here? Let me have some neighbors, I mean. Can we have some service? Let me have some more cottage. Let me have some service.
Gentlemen here, the bird is cheap. Lock, quick, lock the train.
But it's 6 o'clock.
So it's 6 o'clock.
It was due to arrive at 4:45, and it's 6 o'clock.
Down, the clock, it'll be, it'll be.
But it should have been here by now.
Oh, but, it'll
come back when it comes.
Oh my God, the Mr. Lee, you're getting unruly. I've got your place, you take care of me. I love something you want. Just can't see me. Tell me, run for the gentleman, don't you love the God? It always makes me teary. Must be one of them foreigners. My kind of family secret, all to do with herbs. Things like being careful with your coriander. That's what makes the gravy grander.
More hot pies! More hot! More pies!
Excuse me, dear. See to the customers. Walk now, lock, quick, lock the tray.
It's here.
It's where?
Coming up the stair.
I get rid of this door, it's still pretty hot.
It's about to be you, but I don't, you care.
For being,
but we have to prepare.
Be sold if I let him get caught on. Incidentally, dearie, you know Mrs. Mooney. Sales have been so dreary. Tell me, crossing his penniless, what about that loony? Looking kind of beery. Oh, well, gotta come up and say, that'll be threepence.
No, that's good, sir. She, have you been just ever taken? Well, just, oh my God, what's more than high good?
Is there a champion for a king?
Still wet meal.
Johanna, I feel you. They think that walls can hide you. Even now I'm at your window. I am in the dark beside you.
Oh.
Asylum for the mentally deranged.
A madhouse?
I'd keep away from there if I were you.
Johanna! Please! Open the door!
Oh, now, friend, what's all this hollering and shouting?
So, it's you.
Sir, there has been a monstrous perversion of justice. A young woman, as sane as you or I, has been incarcerated there.
Now, would the person by any chance be Judge Turpin's ward, Johanna?
Yes. Yes, he's the devil incarnate who's done this to her.
You watch your tongue. That girl's as mad as the seven seas. I brought her here myself. So, hop it.
You have no right to order me about.
No right, eh? You just hop it or I'm arresting you for disturbing the peace, assailing an officer.
There's no justice in this city. Well, the officers of the law as vicious and corrupted as their masters. Go ahead, please.
Like a nice sit down, is there, dear, after a hard day's work? Let's see. 4 and 3 pence. 4 and 11 pence. That makes £7, 9 shillings, and 4 pence so far this week. Not bad. But that don't include what I had to pay out from a nice cheery wallpaper or the harmonium. And a real bargain it was, too, dear. It being only partly singed when the chapel burnt down. Mr. T, are you listening to me?
Of course.
Then what did I say, huh?
There must be a way to the judge.
The bloody old judge. Always up about the bloody old judge. We got a nice, respectable business here. Money coming in regular, and since we're careful to pick and choose only strangers and such what won't be missed, who's gonna catch on? Ooh, Mr. Todd, I'm so happy I can eat you up a really good. You know what I'd like to do, Mr. Todd? What a dream. If the business stays as good, where I'd really like to go in a year or so. Don't you want to know?
Yes, of course.
Do you really want to know?
Yes, yes, I do.
Oh,
I do.
I've always had a dream. Ever since I was a skinny little slip of a thing, and my rich Aunt Nellie used to take me to the seaside. I can still feel me toes wiggling around in the briny. By the sea, Mr. Todd, that's the life I covet. By the sea, Mr. Todd, oh, I know you'd love it. You and me, Mr. T, we could be alone in a house, but we'd almost own down by the sea.
Anything you say.
Wouldn't that be smashing? With the sea at our gate, we'll have kippered herring. We'll have swum to a strait from the Straits of Bering. Every night in the kip, when we're through our kip, I'll be there slipping off your slippers by the sea with the fishy splashing by the sea. Wouldn't that be smashing down by the sea?
Anything you say, anything you say.
I can see us waking, the breakers breaking, the seagulls squawking. Walking with you, I warm me bones on the esplanade. Have tea and scones with me gay young blade. Then I'll knit a sweater while you write a letter, unless we got better to do.
Anything you say.
Think us now, it'll be underneath our flannel when time. It's just you and me and the English Channel in a cozy retreat, kept all neat and tidy. We'll have jokes over every Friday by the sea. Don't you love the weather by the sea? Bathing dresses. You in a nice, rich navy, and me? Stripes, perhaps. It'd be so quiet that who'd come by it except a seagull. Ooh, ooh, shouldn't try it until it's legal for two. But a seaside wedding could be devised. Me rumpled bedding legitimized. By the sea in our nest, we could share our keepers with the odd pirate guest from the weekend trippers. Have a nice sunny sleep for the guest to rest in. Now and then you could do the guesting by the sea. Marry nice and proper by the sea. Chopper to the seaside, ooh, ooh, by the beautiful sea. Come on, dear, give us a kiss. Lovely.
I'll make them pay for what they did to Lucy.
Now, dear, it's high time you forgot all them morbid fancies. Your Lucy's gone. Poor thing. It's your Nelly now. Here, have a nice bonbon.
Mr. Todd! Mr. Todd, I found her.
Joanna? You found Joanna?
That monster of a judge has had her locked away in a madhouse.
Where?
Where no one can reach her. At Fogg's Asylum. Mr. Todd. She's in there with those screeching, gibbering maniacs!
Madhouse! A madhouse! A madhouse.
Joanna is as good as rescued.
She is?
Where do you suppose all the wig makers of London go to obtain their human hair?
Who knows? The morgue wouldn't be surprised.
Bedlam! They get their hair from the lunatics at Bedlam!
Then you think then?
Why not? For the right amount, they'll sell you the hair off any madman's head.
Go with it, too, if requested. Excuse me, gentlemen, I'm out.
We'll write a letter to this Mr. Fogg offering the highest price for hair the exact shade of Joanna's, which I trust you know.
Yellow?
Not exact enough. I expect to make a credible wig maker out of you, and quickly. There's tawny, and there's golden saffron, there's flaxen, and there's blonde. Now repeat that. Well, repeat that.
Yes, Mr. Todd.
Well?
There's tawny and there's golden saffron, there's waxen and there's blonde.
Good. There's coarse and fine, there's straight and curly, there's
coarse
gray, there's
and fine, there's straight and curly,
there's gray
and yellow, there's
pearly, there's fine.
Sweeney waited too long before, ah, but never again he swore.
Fortune arrived, Sweeney and sang, Sweeney was ready and Sweeney sprang.
Sweeney's troubles went up in smoke, all resolved with a single stroke.
Sweeney was sharp, Sweeney was burning, Sweeney began the engine turning.
Sweeney, 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 Sweeney.
With minor textures and fairer, which makes it rare, but flax and fairer.
Oh,
yes, yes, I know. Cheaper, not rarer.
Here's mine. Here's the pistol. For kill if you must. Kill.
I'll kill a dozen jailers if need be to set her free.
Good, now off. Off. But attention, listen to me once again. After you rescue them, bring her back here. I'll guard the one you have as needs to play.
We'll be with you before the evening's out.
Good.
Mr. Todd, friend. Friend.
Yes.
Most honorable Judge
Turpin.
Most honorable.
Honorable.
I venture thus to write you this urgent
note to warn you that the hot-blooded
young
sailor
has abducted your ward, Johanna.
Johanna.
From the institution where you
so wisely to earn your favor.
I have persuaded the boy to lodge her here tonight at my consorial parlor in Fleet Street.
If you want her again in your arms,
hurry after the night falls.
She will be waiting.
And humble servant, Sweeney Todd.
Give this to Judge Turpin. It's urgent.
Signor Pirelli. Well, it seems the good Lord sent you for me.
It's just me warm heart, dear, rooming up there for all God's creatures.
You know, Mum, there's nothing I wouldn't do for you. If there was a monster or an ogre or anything bad like that what was after you, I'd rip it apart with me bare fists, I wouldn't.
What a sweet child it is.
Even if it was just a man.
A man, dear?
A man what was bad, what might be luring you, all unbeknownst, into his evil deeds like.
What is this? What are you talking about?
Nothing's gonna harm you, not while I'm around.
Of course not, dear, and why should it?
Nothing's gonna harm you, no sir, not while I'm around.
What do you mean?
Demons are prowling everywhere nowadays.
And so they are, dear.
I'll send them howling. I don't care. I got ways.
Of course you do. What a sweet, affectionate child it is.
No one's gonna hurt you. No one's gonna dare.
Well, that's comforting, I'm sure.
Others can deserve you, not to worry. Whistle, I'll be there.
Here, have a nice bonbon.
Demons will charm you with a smile for a while. But in time, nothing can harm you. Not while I'm around.
What is all this foolishness? What are you talking about?
Little things, what I've been wondering, thinking about. It's him, you see, Mr. Todd. Oh, I know you fancy him, but men ain't like women. They ain't what you can trust, as I've lived and learned. Not to worry, not to worry. I may not be smart, but I ain't dumb. I can do it, put me to it. Show me something I can overcome. Not to worry. here.
That's a joint that's in your Pirelli's purse.
What was that?
You weren't even thinking. That's his purse.
Well, silly boy. It's just a little silly something that Mr. T gave me for my birthday.
Mr. Todd gave it to you? Well, where did he get it?
I bought it, dear. In a pawn shop, dear. Come on. Nothing's gonna harm you. Not while I'm around. Nothing's gonna harm you, Toby. Not while I'm around.
Don't understand.
Two quid was in it, two or three.
The governor giving up his purse for 2 quid?
Not for a minute.
Don't you see?
It was in Mr. Todd's parlor that the governor disappeared.
Boys and their fancies. What will we think of next? Come here, dear. Sit by your Aunt Nellie and look at your lovely muffler. How warm it's going to keep you as the day's drawing. And it's so becoming on you.
Mrs. Lovett, fine instrument you've acquired.
Oh, yes, it's my pride and joy.
Well, I hope you have some time, for I'm here today on official business.
Official?
That's right, Mum. You see, there's been complaints.
Complaints?
about the stink from your chimney.
They say at night it's something foul. Public abuse being my responsibility. I'm afraid I'll have to ask you to let me take a look.
At the bakehouse?
That's right, Mum.
But it's locked. And I don't have the key. Mr. Todd upstairs, he's got the key. And he's not here right now.
When will he be back?
I couldn't say, I'm sure. Oh, yes, of course. Mr. Todd's gone to Wapping. He won't be back for hours, and he'll be ever so sorry to have missed you. Why, he was just saying the other day, if only the Beadle would grace my tonsorial parlor, I'd give him the most stylish haircut, the daintiest shape, all for nothing. So why don't you come back when he's here?
Beadle Bamford!
Back already? Look who's here, Mr. T, on some foolish complaint about the bakehouse. He wants the key to give. But there's no worry, is there, sir? Why don't you run up with Mr. Todd and let him fix you up nice and pretty? There'll be plenty of time for the bakehouse later.
Tell me, Mr. Todd, do you pomade the hair? I dearly love a pomaded head.
Pomade, of course! And a nice facial rub with bay rum all for nothing.
I take this very kindly, Mr. Todd.
I am, sir, entirely at your disposal.
Let's hope we can do it quietly. But just to be on the safe side, I'll provide a little musical send-off. Sweet Polly Plunkett lay on the grass, tenderized heavenward.
And he's been yelling to wake the dead. We've got to look after him.
But the judge is coming. I've arranged it.
You worrying about the bloody old judge at a time like this? Come on!
The engine ride, the motor hissed.
And who can see how the road could twist? In Sweeney's letter, the entry smashed. A beetle arrived and a beetle dispatched.
To satisfy the hungry god,
oh, Sweeney Todd, the demon god of
Sweeney
Street, Sweeney, 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 Sweeney.
Just this way, sir. You do me honor, Mr. Todd.
I agree. It would be to our mutual interest to find some arrangement in regard to my poor children's hair.
Your children?
We are one happy family here, sir. And all my patients are my children. To be corrected when they are naughty and rewarded with a sweetie when they're good. But to our business. Here is a charming yellow, a little dull in tone perhaps, but you can soon restore its natural gleam.
No.
Now here, a fine texture for a man. And as you must know, sir, there is always a discount on the hair of a male.
No? This daughter here has had a shade, I see.
Poor child, she needs so much correction. She sings all day and all night and leaves the other inmates sleepless. Come, child, smile for the gentleman, and you shall have his sweetie. Now, where shall I cut?
Joanna!
What is this? What is this?
I'm handcuffed!
What are you?
Stop, Mr. Fogg!
Fire!
I'll fire!
Fire, and I will stop!
I cannot shoot!
You are mad to drop your pistol!
Care of my neighbor, Mrs. Lovett. Thank heaven the sailor did not molest her.
Thank heaven, too, sir, she has seen the error of her ways.
She has?
Oh, yes, sir. Your lesson was well learned, sir. She speaks only of you, longing for forgiveness.
And she shall have it. She'll be here soon, you say.
I think I hear her now.
Oh, excellent, my friend.
Is that her daily footstep on the stair?
I hear nothing.
Yes, isn't that a shadow on the wall?
Where?
There, primping, making herself even prettier.
Even prettier.
Possible.
Pretty women.
Pretty women, yes.
Quickly, sir, a splash of bay rum.
Sit, sir, sit.
Johanna, Johanna.
Pretty women.
Hurry, man.
Pretty women all along.
You're in merry mood again today, man.
Pretty women.
But perhaps the face of a barber, the face of a prisoner in the dock, is not particularly memorable.
Benjamin Barker!
Benjamin Barker!
Tobias!
Grayson!
You!
Oh, dear!
What are you doing here? Speak!
Excuse me, sir. I saw the barber sign and think he asked for a shave.
When? When did you come in?
Oh, sir, I beg of you, whenever I see no mention of it, I
said. A shave, eh? At your service. Whatever you may have seen, your cheeks are in as much need of the razor now as before. Sit, sir. Sit!
The oven with her.
Why did you scream? Does the judge live still?
He was holding. He was clutching onto my skirt, but now he's finished.
Leave them to me. Open the doors.
No!
Open the doors, no! I say!
No, don't go near her!
What's the matter with you? It's only some meddling old beggar. Oh, no! She said, you knew she lived. From the first moment I walked into your shop, you knew my Lucy lived.
I was only thinking of you.
Lucy.
Your Lucy, a crazy hag, picking bones and rotten spuds out of the alley ash cans. Would you have wanted to know that she ended up like that?
You lied to me.
No, no, not lied at all.
Lucy,
said she took the poison, she did never said that. She died before she knew that the queen was gone. The rest was just lying there in bed. Should have been
lost, Mr. Mack, the big peddler,
said poor
thing. Oh, my God.
Lovett,
You're a bloody wonder, eminently practical and yet appropriate as always. As you've said repeatedly, there's little point in dwelling on the past. No, come here, my love.
I swear I thought was something for the best.
Come here, my love. Once dead, he's dead. The history of the world, my pet.
Oh, Mr. Todd, leave it to me.
He's learned forgiveness and try to forget.
By the sea, Mr. Todd, we can't be cozy by the sea, Mr. Todd, when there's no one knows.
And life is for the alive, my dear. So let's keep living it. Just keep living it. Really living it. A barber and his wife. She was beautiful. A foolish barber and his wife. She was his reason and his life. And she was beautiful. And she was virtuous. And
of gentlemen who never thereafter were heard of again.
He trod upon the path that you have trod, did Sweeney Todd.
the demon barber of Fleet Street.
He kept a shop in London town, of fancy clients and good renown.
And what if none of their souls were saved? They went to their maker impeccably shaved.
By Sweeney! By Sweeney Todd! The demon barber of Fleet Street!
Well, if Stephen Sondheim set out to scare his audience, he certainly has tonight. Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street, a musical thriller, music and lyrics by Stephen Sondheim, book by Hugh Wheeler, after the play by Christopher Bond. And you can hear the audience. Applause for our cast, and right now the bare stage, the innards of a Victorian factory. Applause there for Joseph Evans as Pirelli in his Houston Grand Opera debut. Applause for Barry Busse as the Beadle. Adair Gockley as the Beggar Woman. You saw her as an articulate sheep in Candide and as the Shepherd Boy in Tosca. Applause there for Will Roy as Judge Turpin. And Lee Merrill, who was a member of the Houston Opera Studio, as Johanna. Her last role was as a Satyrette in La Callisto at the studio. Applause there for Stephen Jacob in his Houston Grand Opera debut as Toby Ragg, now with a white wig. And for Cris Groenendaal of Anthony Hope, this is his debut in Houston. He was with the original company of Sweeney Todd. Applause there for Joyce Castle as Mrs. Lovett. She appeared with Houston Grand Opera and Threepenny Opera. And a big round of applause for Timothy Nolen in the title role. Timothy Nolen, who made his Houston Grand Opera debut in the title role in Carlisle Floyd's Willie Stark, appeared last season in the world premiere of Leonard Bernstein's A Quiet Place. And when not performing on stage, he is co-director of the Lake George Opera. Applause there for Houston Grand Opera's music director, John Demain, who's asking the orchestra to stand and share the applause. And now Tim Nolen has gone off stage to bring out, I would guess it's going to be, yes it is, Stephen Sondheim. And the applause is being led by the entire cast. He is applauding them. He has been here working with the cast. And this, the first opera performance of Sweeney Todd, Now joining them on stage, Hal Prince, who directed it on Broadway and directed it for Houston Grand Opera, assisted by Arthur Mazzella, who is likewise sharing the applause. Of course, Mr. Prince and Mr. Sondheim have worked very closely on several of their Broadway hit collaborations. The set for the original production by Eugene Lee, which included a rather ingenious Victorian barber's chair, the mechanical noise all through the second act was the chair shooting victims down into the basement bakehouse. Applause continues from this full house here. Question, is Sweeney Todd an opera? That we leave to you. Once again, the chorus was prepared by Connolly Ballard with musical preparation by Stephen Sulich, assisted by Craig Boehmler. Sweeney Todd will be performed through Sunday afternoon, and then with one day off, Monday, we'll be back on the Jones Hall stage from Tuesday through next Sunday matinee. Plenty of opportunities to come to Jones Hall and see this, and believe me, it must be seen as well as heard to be believed. Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street, live from Jones Hall, brought to you this evening by First City Bank. Reaching further, doing more.
Late the other night, my neighbor Hal was getting ready for a fishing trip, and he dropped by to borrow a couple of bucks from me. He said, we're leaving for the lake at 4 a.m., and this little bait camp we're stopping at never takes checks or credit cards. You should see the sign over their door, no bucks, no bait. And I said, well, Hal, I'll be happy to put up a couple of bucks for your fishing trip, but you know you wouldn't have this problem if you had a First Net card. Why is that, he said, and I explained. Well, when you're banking at First City, you can use a First Net card for cash at automated teller machines any time of the day or night. First Net is good throughout the entire state and all around the country, for that matter. So Hal said, well, sounds like it pays to have a First Net card. And I said, it does, Hal, in more than 600 cities, towns, and even fishing villages. We're First City, reaching further, doing more. Members FDIC.
And so we come to the end of an entire season of live opening nights from Houston Grand Opera, Jones Hall, brought to you by First City Bank. I'd like to thank all of you for joining us right here on KLEF and in Jones Hall for these productions, and we invite you to join us next season when Houston Grand Opera begins its 1984-85 season in October with the American premiere of Philip Glass's Akhenaten. Our recording and broadcast engineers are John Lehman and Mike Lamb of Dove & Oat Recording Company. Have a very, very good summer. For Houston Grand Opera, this is Ira J. Black. These broadcasts brought to you by First City Bank. Reaching further, doing more.
And you're tuned to KLEF Houston Stereo 94.5. Stay tuned for The Late Show. That's coming up next.